we will move on to the next session, which is the panel discussion. Dr. V. Krishnamurthy, Professor Rajendra N. Sonar, Srimati Shweta Purana, and the session is being moderated by Dr. Harish Iyer, former head Regional Center for E-Governance, IIT Hyderabad. Now I would request Professor Harish to take the lead.
My name is Harish. I was still recently the head of Research Center on E-Governance at IIIT Hyderabad, which Dr. Krishnamurthy had just mentioned, the startup ecosystem and so on. My very first live project to do with ICT was roughly 35 years back, and it was on AI, 35 years back, and that was in Singapore, and it used to be called Expert Systems then. Some of you are familiar with this domain, you know that there were two sort of dichotomy, whether the expert system is the right way to go or the neural networks are the right way to go, and I'm talking about 30 odd years back, my very first project. And then I left IIIT, retired 3 months back, and this AI is again in news. And in between, if you recall, 15 years back, 20 years back, probably very few people spoke about AI. This is the characteristic of technology, that it makes its presence, it emerges from hibernation suddenly with a lot of roar. You hear a lot of jargons, neural networks, and you know, Bitcoin, or blockchain, or IoTs, and suddenly you feel very overwhelmed by all of it. You often wonder how much of it is hype, how much of it is reality, is it relevant to you? Often you are forced into something because everyone else around you is doing. You sort of feel you're not up to the mark because you're not doing an IoT project or a blockchain project. So it's really a very tricky subject, this technology. And to help us unravel some of the truths, some of the exaggerations about AI and blockchain, I have the honor of having an excellent, very learned panel. Dr. Krishnamurthy, Dr. Murthy has already been introduced, you've heard him. I won't introduce him again. We also have Dr. Sonar. His PhD itself was on AI, if I'm not mistaken. So, the right person to speak about AI and other emerging technologies. And Ms. Shweta Kurana, Director of Intel. They're all names which Mr. Rao has already mentioned in his speech, and they're all absolutely senior. You must have heard them, you must have met them in other forums. So, I'll be doing them injustice by introducing them anymore. The whole idea is, you know, we have started with sort of a bang, and then Dr. Murthy also had to rush through his PPT. So we would like to use this panel discussion to sort of slow down and sort of reintroduce these topics from ground up. Because the charter before us is some of you are already working on AI or blockchains and other technologies. Some of you have just heard about them and you're not sure what they are. So we'll be taking our time, roughly about an hour or so, to introduce what is AI and blockchain and so on. And then we'll speed up a little bit and we'll discuss what exactly is happening on the ground, the realities of, from the government perspective, from industry perspective, from a academic perspective. And then we'll open the session to questions from the floor. So hopefully we'll manage our time well, and there'll be enough time for you to interact with the expert panel here. My job is easy. All I have to do is ask questions and then wait for the answers. We'll be focusing essentially on AI and blockchain and not on other things. Maybe I'll start with Dr. Sonar himself and ask him, Because you also have heard all sorts of jargons, neural networks, and I mentioned expert systems and machine learning and so on. But let's start with understanding, what is AI? How would you, I mean, you heard so much about it, what is AI?
So good morning to all. Thanks, Professor. In fact, he mentioned about 35 years back, it's quite senior to me. I did my first course in 1992, almost 27 years back. And he's rightly pointed, that time it was mostly expert system. So what expert system trying to automate the human expertise. So for example, if you're an expert, you're a doctor, you're a lawyer, can your intelligence be, to a certain extent, mimicked by the machines? That means, can machine work like a doctor, machine work like a lawyer? And that's how the AI started. I think you must have heard about Alan Turing. He was one of the first British mathematicians who invented that Turing test. And he thought that by end of last century, it should have been possible to make a machine as intelligent as human beings. But still, that's not possible, because there are some of the attributes anyway I'll cover in my lecture, which are, like, machines are not typically creative. So what is artificial intelligence to me? It's like trying to understand our intelligent behavior, the way we solve the problem, the way we reason the problem. Can that be done by machine? That means, can that be incorporated into machine or embedded into machines so that machine becomes more intelligent? So AI is more broader. It consists of a lot of things, under that. And can be, for example, machine learning, or it can be expert systems, or it can be genetic algorithms and so on. Now, what is not an emerging technology? As sir said, a lot of people who are already working, like if you come to IIT Bombay, there are professors who have been working in AI almost more than 30 years now. So industry has picked up quite a bit. Like if you see the last 70 years, a lot of AI, and especially it has become more mainstream application. It's not sitting in the lab or something. AI has become more mainstream. So machine learning, you can say, is more subset of overall artificial intelligence, and deep learning goes more into deeper. That means you understand the concepts at very grassroots level. Like good examples, image recognition, face recognition. So it tries to understand what are the features of the images and it tries to recognize it. So that's what the current. Only my this one, like the way industry is portraying, like anybody can learn AI and start working on AI. That's not the case, Because you need to understand, neural networks are not that easy to understand. You have to model them correctly, you have to have the right set of data, you have to train it properly, you have to test it, and then you have to use it in normal application. So it requires a lot of understanding of all these technologies well. Modeling, this one, especially if you are from the stat and maths background, it can be quite helpful. And I think you can add.
Yes, Dr. Murthy had to rush through. Incidentally, his PhD also is doubly strong in this. So he had to rush through his PPT. So maybe we'll ask Dr. Murthy.
Actually, the first time when we were doing a patent in '85, we heard the course like AI, artificial intelligence. Immediately, we requested our dean and other people that we want to take this as a Professor Arun Agarwal, he was our teacher. So please, this course, AI. So we were so excited, and then we wanted to do something in AI. Fortunately for me, I have joined in KBCS project of the Government of India in 1996. So there we have developed a lot of systems, expert systems, and the first expert systems that are developed are using Prolog language for the import-export policy for the government. So of course, after 95, it has been changed. So just I want to demystify what is AI. Is as per definition, if you are going, it is to develop computer systems at which, at the moment, humans are better. That means computer systems can do it much faster, the number crunching and those things. But human beings are much more faster in identifying certain perception activities like vision, natural language, understanding some of the languages, following some of the commands, and some of the experts who are in civil engineering, medicine, and other domains who can exhibit their intelligence to do some certain things or game playing. So these are the activities which are there in AI. But AI is not a single technology; it is various technologies which are together, which are combining, and various disciplines, like you said, mathematics, computer science, and then image processing algorithms, and then image acquisition, a lot of processing hardware. So all required together for doing the AI systems. So just one thing that nowadays some of the people are thinking that data is important. Yes, deep learning today, for the last 2010 onwards, you have that lot of data, and then give it to the deep learning network, and then you can produce some of the classification. So neural networks will be doing some of the classification much faster than the human experts. So that's where most of the people are using the neural networks and deep learning for this purpose. So a lot of applications can be designed if you have a good data, and at the same time metadata, as you have rightly said, you can design the application. So I'll stop at this stage and then.
It's an honor to be sitting with two gentlemen who have the PhD in AI, and let me apologize for the colleges. So I'm going to try and share a very social scientist perspective on artificial intelligence and emerging technologies. In fact, when Dr. Murthy was sharing his presentation, what struck me is that we are living in a very differently defined world today, right? Which means possibly even our alphabets have to be seen in a different context. So during this presentation, it just struck me that, you know, okay, A is artificial intelligence, B is blockchain, C is cloud computing, D is datafication, E is edge computing, and I can go right up to Z on this. Which essentially means that all of us need to now look at learning different skill sets. And these skill sets may be just learning about technology, knowing how to manage an AI system, but also trying to understand what is the difference between AI and artificial intelligent machine and human beings. And that is what I would really want to share going ahead.
Can we request, Dr. Murthy, can if you suppose if you were to take one or two initiatives which have been highlighted as the key areas for the government, what exactly, how exactly are you making machines intelligent, say in agriculture or education? Just one or two examples, a little bit of details so that we get a flavor for how in a live environment it's working.
So let us see the agriculture domain. So the computerization has done in various fields, and most of the systems have developed. Say for example, crop insurance, agricultural crop insurance, and all the seeds, selection of the seeds, and then seed distribution supply chain management system. Or the farmers who are having some pesticides within on the crops, and then if there are any bursts on the crop, and how they can contact the agricultural information officers, who can extension officers, who can help them in finding out what type of agriculture the manures they have to be used, or the what type of medicine that they have used for their countries. So all these are developed in silos. Say for example, from a farmer point of view, so I have started a crop, I do not know what type of seeds are need to be selected from which place. So if I have decided that I want to get that, so the AI system can, if you can integrate the data of all the people, and there is already the, what is that, the soil health card is there with the government of India, NIC Health developing that. That means being based on that, if I have a farm, and then using the soil health card, you can find out what type of crop can be sowed at what time. So that information, the moment my Aadhaar number is there, my identity is there with you, with the government, and my form details are also there, my soil has got already there. If immediately it can be, and there is a weather prediction out there, linking these data, and then giving me that, yes, from next month onward there will be a lot of rains, so you should be ready in a position to see this crop. So that this is the crop that you want to start. Such information is much more useful. So people are using AI for these purposes. And then I can give you another specific example. So suppose there is a farmer in my own native place in Visakhapatnam, near Visakhapatnam, Srikakulam district in Andhra Pradesh itself. We are implementing with the agricultural extension center, where the crop, if the farmer has some pests on the crop, and he takes that image, sends it to the agricultural extension center, and he will say that I have this so and so thing in my crop. Immediately the agricultural extension center officer will go, research officer will go to the database and then see that what type of best cities and what type of medicines and mentors that he has to use. That name, obviously, he cannot read that that is a chemical name. The farmer may not be knowing it. It will be sent an SMS to the mobile phone. Not only that, it goes to the nearby distributors who are producing that medicine to the to this farmer. Immediately, like you were just there, so immediately four or five people who are distributors of this, they will come and then fertilizers. They will come and then immediately call that farmer and then provide that you have this problem. I will give you the best price for that. So like that, he can get a better manure and the timely action can be taken from this. So these are some of the techniques where you require a lot of not only just computerization, digitization of the information, but use that information, analyze using data analytics, and then providing some of the AI techniques to fill it out and then. The AI techniques, image processing techniques are required by taking the image of that crop, of the plant, and then find out what type of patterns are there, and then identify the disease. So for these things that people are using it, some of the data analytics, video analytics people are using for video surveillance. I think I heard that IIT Hyderabad has put more than 1 lakh cameras across the city of Hyderabad for video surveillance. They are doing it remotely. So some of these applications, yes, which are required for the citizens, which require high-end technology of image processing or natural language processing and some of these. And some of the people are developing chatbots where you can give the advices to various people. So those are the things that are coming.
Use of mobile app for capturing a crop image, because I remember right now there is a app available in Singapore. Grievance is a common issue across all states. Most municipal corporations have introduced some kind of mobile app for recording issues or the other. One of the things that Singapore has done is that they've gone a little ahead. They are saying that most people don't know whom to complain. The complaints can be varied. It's just a small pothole on the road I want to complain about. Blown out bulb can be complained about. Some unknown, some suspicious person lurking somewhere. So the complaint can be anything. And if I have a problem, who do I contact? Let's say I have a suspicious person. I call up the police in India. I have a pothole. Do I call the municipal corporation or who? What number is it? I don't know. So what Singapore has done right now is they have an app which uses artificial intelligence. That's why I'm giving this example, where the citizen doesn't have to know anything about whom to contact. So he just clicks the problem. It could be a person loitering around. It could be whatever you can imagine. And then this goes to a central area where the AI analyzes what the citizen is likely to be saying as a problem, and then that it transfers that information to the right department or the authority. So one way you're actually applying your AI, you're not no longer in the theory zone, you're trying to come down to usefulness for every citizen, is where you're giving it a bit of intelligence, and then, it may go wrong also, it doesn't matter, but at least the attempt is in the right direction. I think even from the examples that you keep hearing from experts, we know that in some areas, AI is probably a little bit more smarter than other areas. For instance, image is something which keeps coming up. You get photographs, and then you can do tons of photographs, it can do face recognition, all that. But is AI smart with text? Is AI smart with voice? To the same extent, maybe Dr. Sona, do you have some opinion on relative skill or power of AI today vis-a-vis various types of data?
We have cyber-physical systems available all throughout our lives, right? We see that around us, whether that's smart lighting, whether that's a smart elevator you're stepping into, or any other system, even Google Maps when you look at it. Now, some apply artificial intelligence and the others don't. So the whole question where the power of compute comes in is, is the application of artificial intelligence really worth the negotiation which we or one would do when you decide on what is the computational power you would want to address, vis-a-vis what is the benefit which you drive out? Similarly, what is the carbon footprint which you're creating? Because training machines, and I'm sure both of them agree, is not an easy job at all. There is a carbon footprint which you really leave behind. You have to understand what the damages are. In certain areas, certain use cases like health, transportation, logistics, we've seen some great value emerging by applying artificial intelligence. In certain use cases, a simple computational power to manage it in a very simple automated manner would help solve the problem.
A lot of, in fact, they know even, sorry, don't know even the basics of, you know, like, suppose you tell them, if my integer is 8 bit, what is the maximum value you can ever assign to that? Somebody says 999, somebody says 32. They don't know that the binary number, the basis is, you know, base is 2 and 2 raised to n minus 1, that maximum value you can assign is 255. These basics are completely, after doing 4 years of engineering, I don't know, and they are all ML enthusiasts. They are all, everybody wants to learn. Because this is not their problem.
One of the directors in open, what we did actually, we sat with the doctor. He had almost his 25 years of experience. We sat in, he typically prescribes some 25-30 medicines. We took each and every medicine and tried to understand, to prescribe that medicine, what doctors use. You know, so for example, what is the age of the patient, gender of the patient, what are the current medications the person is going through, what are the current symptoms, what are the current pathology reports are saying. And based on that, we prescribe the medicine. So what we try to do, we try to automate or clone the knowledge of the doctor to certain extent. Now what is the advantage? I don't really need a lot of data to get started. Because sitting with the expert can actually automate the knowledge to a great extent. And then when you receive the cases or data, you can go on building the knowledge. So what I mean, as an academician, it's my more broader perspective rather than very you know, specific to a particular technology. Dr. Kuthi also said, the problem of AI is a very narrow focus. And if you want to think everything in perspective, it's very
important. Yeah, I'll just start with that. Back to the industry perspective, the expectation from academics is also to look at the applicability of all the advanced artificial intelligence which is getting developed. Are any of you familiar with the model machine experiment by MIT? If not, if you can just Google that and attempt that once. I think in Dr. Bhutti's presentation, I saw about autonomous driving, right? So when industries, as Intel and the other industries, are developing advanced AI solutions, what they really need is inputs on how exactly should we train the machines to think in a moral and ethical manner. And the moral machine experiment which MIT is leading today is doing exactly that. It places you as a key person who has to take a decision how the autonomous car would drive on the roads. What would happen if in case you're going, you have a three fork option. On the first fork you have a pregnant woman, on the second fork you have an elderly gentleman. Have you attempted that? Okay, you have an elderly gentleman, and on the third fork, if you go there, you end up killing the passenger. So if that is a decision a machine has to take in the future, then somewhere down the line all of us have a responsibility, specifically academia, government and the industry, to come together and to figure out how this functions going ahead.
So while especially in the government, there are a lot of issues which are there, the legal issues also that she has mentioned about autonomous vehicle. So when the such autonomous vehicle has been with an accident and killed a person, whom should be sure? Whether the developer or the car manufacturer or the person who owns it. So some of these issues need to be addressed. Last 20 countries are also discussing some of these things. Like for example, telemedicine, if they use that, the remote doctor has prescribed some medicines, and then that becomes some of the legal and ethical issues also. So when you are using the data which is there, and then in the health especially, data privacy also comes into picture. So anonymization of the data and then distribution of data is very important. And yes, as people have been mentioning, that data is the if that is the case, then how? What is the data exchange platform that we have to use it for betterment of the common people? They should not be, this data should not be used to the, you know, like for example, income tax data. If it is given to some people can use it in a better manner, and what is the purchasing? or suppose if you have dealt with some people who have delivered some goods to you, and still the credit facility and the loan facility can be given by the bank, rather than you have purchased so and so thing, that means your income is very high and hence it will be misused by some other people. So those are the things that we need to address it in a more congenial manner and for the betterment of the common man. That is it.
I'll just start one thing to Dr. Murthy is saying. I think another critical aspect is diversity of data sets, which at this point in time for any AI solution to be actually effective is a huge challenge.
Thank you. I would like to really thank all the panel members here, experts, and we would open session for questions. Feel free, it can be a comment, it can be a question, but keep it brief, identify yourself directly to any of the panelists.
I am Soumya Achar, Additional Director from Centralized Processing Center, CPC Bangalore. CPC Bangalore is a part of the Income Tax Department. So there are two or three things which I would want to put across to the panel. First being, Income Tax Department has been one of the primary absorbers of technology, as you would be knowing. And we have improved, you know, in terms of delivery, we have probably in the past two decades, we have achieved a lot, great number of milestones. So, respectfully differing with Mr. Murthy, I would just like to point out the transformations which have happened in the department. That is, as much as the delivery system has improved, as much as the services have improved, the jobs at the lower levels have definitely gone. Of course, it's become a top-heavy thing, and which is obvious because there's more of mental work that has to be done. So accordingly, a lot of ground level jobs are gone. So this, the same thing is going to definitely happen in a lot of sectors. And when we are talking about reskilling, upskilling, I do not think that it is such an easy thing to achieve in a short span of time. And especially when you have the Jeff Bezos and Elon Musks of the world driving the progress of the government, of the world, and the governments just towing the lines of all these big corporates without actually putting in any much of thought into it. Because we are progressing in a certain direction and we are calling that progress. And definitely we are going to reach a stage where large number of populations are definitely going to be unemployed. I don't think we have really thought through this. Even if we ensure a universal basic income, I do not know how you're going to engage the minds after that, because that is a real, real problem. Because an idle mind of any person is, it's a devil's workshop, as we typically say it. So that's a thing which the governments really need to think about, and as policymakers, we and you as contributors to the policy should somewhere keep this in mind and define what is progress basically, and where do we stop it, or whether if this is going to be the way, then we should have a clear roadmap, because definitely AI, blockchain, and all the ML and everything is going to bring in a lot of improvements in our lives. If we talk about quality of life, definitely it's improved. So the first thing is that. Second is a moral code that needs to be put in place. Government again reacts very slowly to changes. How are you going to put that into place? So these two things basically I just wanted to put across the panel so that
Ma'am, your point is very well taken. I think we'll probably, there is also a FICCI NASSCOM EY report which actually says 35% of a lot of jobs that we know will be gone, and only about 15% of new kinds of jobs will be created. And when we talk about reskilling and all that, I am absolutely with you that even if you can reskill, there's going to be a elapsed time. Dr. Sunar also mentioned, not like I can go tomorrow to IIT and then in 2 months I become an expert in any subject. So there will be a huge amount of disruption. There will be people like you and me, because I'm of the same opinion, but there will also be a lot of people who don't agree with this. So I think this is something that has to be taken up, but the point is very well taken. I think it's important that all of us also not blindly adopt technology, mouthing the same slogans that it will create
jobs and no jobs will be lost. You have to analyze it from your perspective. That's very crucial. I totally agree.
And I'm very glad you brought this topic up, because this is a frequent discussion which we actually have in the Ministry of Charity. How many of you know that India is the first country to actually create artificial intelligence as a subject in K-12? Which means children from class 9th to 12th will be studying and be assessed in a subject called AI, right? Because we could possibly pick up a physics or a biology or a chemistry or a computer science. So there are steps which the government is taking, and just to share with you, when India made this announcement, which was just a couple of months ago, just 3 months ago, China followed suit 6 days later. Right? So while the government, I'm sure, is thinking about that, Dr. Murthy can answer that. World Economic Forum has recently released a report, a fresh report, on the skills which one requires for a 2022 outlook. And that is what it says. It says that any skill which requires manual dexterity, endurance, and precision is going to become outdated, which is a fact, and which is unfortunate for a very populous country like India and a developing economy like India. But it also says that there are certain skills, creativity, originality, and emotional intelligence, which I think is extremely high as a skill set in any field, is what would really work when going ahead in a world which is fueled by artificial intelligence or any of the emerging technologies.
I just I agree, government is doing on AI. But recently there was an article in Times of India, why not government introducing the coding at 8th standard, 9th standard? This is surprising to me. You are taking AI courses, but you are not taking coding courses. Because what drives the world is behind the scene. Then we'll be using only Google APIs and Amazon APIs. We'll not be developing our own APIs. So we'll be like the slaves of all these technology big giants. That means our kids should be taught how to do C++ coding, how to fundamentally develop your own logic. Otherwise, learning AI to me doesn't make any sense unless and until I understand the coding well.
Absolutely, sir. Because I'm an engineer, so having graduated in the late 90s, I completely agree with you that a single piece of code cannot be written by engineers.
Who owns the API? Google owns it. Microsoft owns it. Amazon owns it. What you are doing? You are just using their APIs. Where their APIs are sitting on cloud? Where your data will go? Can't we have like China policy or own people, own algorithms? Why are you not bringing that thinking? A lot of people cannot even think of. I hired one person who had experience in service industry for 3-4 years. We develop algorithms in AI. He used to say, sir, I have never seen such kind of code in my life. Because they don't have data structure, they don't learn algorithms. So government should introduce for coding, the basic discipline of, and then introduce the AI. Because who will be happy if you introduce some courses, all these big vendors? Because you use their APIs and then there will be. So we don't own the data much of the time. Who owns our data? Google owns the data. You are all uploading everything with Google. When I'm traveling from Mumbai to Hyderabad, Google knows at what time I landed on airport when I came to Hyderabad. Do you own that data? No. Look at the China. So why we are not following the China policy? Most of the things should be indigenous, because especially even when you talk about the privacy and confidentiality, why government, I think, good initiative that they want all these big vendors to set up their clouds in India. Because what your data doing, and recently what happened to Facebook, they have been fined, this one. So all these issues are going to come, because we are not custodians of our data, somebody else is custodian of it. We are not custodians of our own IP, API security, your IP sits with somebody else. I think government should follow China's strategy as far as the AI is concerned, because they own a lot of their own data. When you own a lot of data, you can get a lot of insights.
So this is Raj Subhas, sir. If we go back some 30 years back, AI means like it's something like we can't imagine 35 years back. 80s, 70s, we had very, we have very common life. Now, if you see after 35 years, 40 years, now completely, I think the entire human society is run by the AI only. I would say maybe it's a bold statement, I don't know whether God is omnipresent or not, but AI is now omnipresent. And And also like the most mammoths said, like the mammoths said, like even Sir B.K. Murthy sir also said like that. Of course, in each and every minute, AI is been part of our life and it is inseparable in every activity. Even the person literate or illiterate or e-learning person or not, even you don't know about the computers or not. Like another thing is that on the other side, challenging issue like there are so many on limitations or whatever you call drawbacks or challenges, whatever it may be, like the privacy issue and the security and the spam mails, spam messages, spam calls. Like that, every day we are seeing like in the news, yeah, that person gone already lose his 1 lakh rupees telling his OTP.
I think the point is well taken, sir. I think
yes, sir. The security system should be developed by the government, like ma'am also said, like in the other way, the other words, like moral or ethics or whatever it may be, like
sure, sure.
It should be secured, like
sure.
So it's my.
I think given that we are still evolving, I think that will be factored in. Any questions, sir? Can you say, is it a comment or a question, please?
Yeah.
Question.
I'm just asking for a view. I'm Yudhishthir from SCUT Chandigarh, and my question is for Dr. Murthy. You would agree every technology has a life cycle, it has its advantages. Do you feel that blockchain technology has matured enough, especially for the government, to invest in a big way? I'm just not talking about research. And do you feel that it is the time is right for states and governments to invest extensively in blockchain?
Some of the applications that I have mentioned, those are very really useful for the common citizens. So the government should pitch in for these things, like for example, land records or education certificates. Some of these use cases which are there, financial transactions. So some of these use cases, yes, you need to use some of these blockchain technology. It uses a secure mechanism of whatever he said, that some of the frauds you can control. I mean, you can't eliminate completely. No technology is foolproof. The moment you say that 1024 bits of security algorithm you can create, and tomorrow somebody else will be to breach that. So that those are all, I mean, always the thieves and the people who are doing the miscreants are always the heads of the people who are doing it.
I fully understand it has a huge potential, secondary the project of blockchain. I want to see from the perspective of the government that I should not be investing in something at 5 years down the line. I'm seeing something else, I will have to invest in something else, and this technology has become outdated or.
Yes. Are you using Hyperledger or what are you?
We just about to start a pilot project from ETU. It's a blockchain based land record system.
No, I think even Dr. Murthy will be hard-pressed to answer that question, because technology will, investment in technology is always risky, especially if it is at the stage blockchain is in. So the only way you would de-risk is to use some open source like Hyperledger, which uses it's a global community is working on it, so there are some agreed upon standards and so on. So and anyway, it doesn't disrupt your core system. You're only extending it through a separate blockchain environment. So in case this Hyperledger dies and someone else comes in, you should hope that you'll be able to port that across to that.
I think I spoke on
the stuff developing most of the, because the systems are already legacy systems in most of the applications. So when you are using new technology, you are only using on top of the existing systems. So when you are using the existing system, however secure on the top of it, there may be some loopholes, any weak link can create a problem. So the security, you need to see that what are the loopholes that you are there, and then plug in those things.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Manav Saurabh from Bihar Finance Services. I have a question that
See, we have a platform where the integration of the problems which are coming from academics have been taken. Secondly, there are problems in the industries and they have been taken. But what we see that we have major problems at the lower level of the bureaucracy. Is there any platform where we are taking the issues from the lower level of the bureaucracy? Or like any portal is there where they can get registered and put up their problems and then the emerging technologies can solve them?
Thinking of creating such platforms, still it is in the development process. Yeah, like, I mean, for example, for the citizen interface, yes, actually people are, I mean, government is working very importantly. Suppose somebody wants to have an appointment with me, you need not find out where and call me. There's a portal you can directly log on, yes, and then you have some system, and then Swagatam is the one.
So, for these technologies, do we have any portals like that?
Yes, under the 100 days agenda, there is this NIC is developing Swagatam for interfacing with the government departments. If you want to get an appointment or discuss with some of your problems with the government department, Swagatam is the platform coming up within the next 100 days. As part of the 100 days agenda.
Yes, sir. One question, sir. From Intel also. Because there is a lot of gap between industry and academy. Especially, academy is so much of lagging, they are not meeting with the industry requirements. So, recently we have started on emerging technologies like IoT, AI and ML. This is like a short-term courses, which is where actually industry, what actually they are using. We are taking the inputs from the industry, and the same we are injecting into the students other than this, in addition to their curriculum. So in this regard, we are planning to establish a COEs in AP. So we need mighty support in this regard.
And from news, what I understand is government all across the world is not very much comfortable with Bitcoin. So what do you people think about Bitcoin, and what is the future of Bitcoin in India in perspective of government and its regulation?
Like smart contracts or land records and other things. We wanted to take the technology and then use it, not implement Bitcoin.
Yeah, so I mean, in future also Bitcoin is not going to be in India.
In future, I cannot say what will happen. The technology is changing very fast. But as of now, the technology for Bitcoin, which is blockchain technology, and then various applications, various variants of that, is being finding out some of the use cases where you can use it for the common.
For the security aspect. Yes sir, my name is Sudhir. Hello. Hello. Yes sir, my name is Sudhir. I am from Cross Kalyan Academy for Skill Analysis. I want to get that, where can I get that authorized content to impart training to that students? AI and machine learning.
Authorized
content.
You need to develop. Recently, some Vishakhapatnam startup company, they want to train all these engineers in ML and AI. And what they have done, they have actually gone to, see, for example, you can go to MITs and Stanfords of the world. Just take, for example, if they have some fast track course, 6 months or this one, take the content. So what they did, actually, they gave them some exhaustive content where NLP was there, big data was there, machine learning, deep machine learning, this one. And then they sent me to, review it. So what I said is just get the whatever base courses, compile them and send to experts. So they may be, you're talking about the curriculum.
Yes.
Yeah. So I think that's the best way to start. And have the courses which are popular.
We have content.
Yeah.
Curriculum or content?
Curriculum along with content.
We have another couple of minutes. So we can just keep the question short and then point it.
From West Bengal.
Sorry. Yes.
I just wanted to ask one question. Like we have been hearing about machine learning, deep learning. So I really agree with the panel. Like you really need qualified engineers and people who really need to be strong in mathematics and in neural networks. Sir also talked about the coding part. Now we see that since it is the buzzword, many are talking of courses, 6 months, 7 months, 8 months. So how do we guarantee the accuracy of AI, because we are depending on a machine, and until and unless the person who is actually writing the code, he has in-depth knowledge about it, then the entire thing could go haywire once you put it on a live system.
You know, any program that you do, leave alone AI, anything you do, the programmer can actually insert malicious code into your traditional systems too. So the controls that you have, the governance system that you have for the entire project management lifecycle, that will still apply, but there are still, your point is also well taken, because I'm not sure we fully understand how the AI gained this knowledge. It's, a lot of it is still a black box. So I think in the afternoon session, when you hear more about AI, you probably, we can take it up during that time also.
I spent 10 years of my life in programming. Yeah. I still have a doubt.
No, but the answer is still, we don't know how to ensure that AI is not malicious. AI can be malicious, which is why the government also is worried, users are also worried, and you have to take proper precautions.
Science fiction doesn't help that perception any which ways. I don't know how many of you have grown up with science fiction, but you do expect to see a Terminator around whenever you see conversations around artificial intelligence, which is not factual. At the end of the day, it is the person who's writing the algorithm who is responsible for how the machine will react, and I'm sure professors are not going to deal with that. Another important part is that the person who's writing the algorithm should not transfer his biases to the algorithm, because that is going to control the future. And we want the future world to be better than what it is.
Similarly, see, physical systems are difficult to tamper. So, for example, if you have a register in guest house, tampering is very difficult, you know, but in digital, it can be easily tampered. So, for example, if you are giving some report to, say, sonography report or some X-ray report to a machine learning, and you just change some pixel, which is made for something infection, the system will never figure it out. That means your input, it's not only the program, but the input given can be also tampered. And if input given is tampered, so for example, if, say, car insurance. Now suppose you are taking a picture and you just modify the picture, the person, the algorithms or machines will never figure it out that it has been changed. Unless and until some watermark or something you put at the original. You got my point. Suppose I take a camera, I take a picture and I modify it. Just like, you know, like WhatsApp, it allows you to change the picture. You can make, if you are a, you want to change your complexion, you can actually make it. So it's very difficult for, you know, AI algorithm to figure it out. Whether it's an, is a real image or if somebody has tampered it, you know. So that is also a risk, you know, it's not only algorithmic, but also from a good point of view.
Thank you, sir.
Inherently, AI system, AI programming itself doesn't guarantee 100% optimal.
Sure. Yeah, good morning, sir. I'm Abhilasha Vyas from GSFC University. They are more going towards the declarative paradigm, in which they are more looking, focusing on the what part of that problem. They are not focusing on the how that should be solved. So how we can motivate our students to work on that? Right now when I'm saying write a Java program, they know the IDEs are available and that IDE is going to give a whole structure. When I'm saying you have to work on a blank screen and now you have to write that code, they find it very difficult to at least write the import statements and how many imports are required for that program. So how, like, as a faculty, I can motivate my students to work on this area?
What you actually, you have to bring them, you have to give them assignments. See, C is the base language to start with, because it helps you to write everything at a grassroots level. If you are going on higher level languages and a lot of IDEs are there, you will even learn the program. The way we learn. See, I passed out in 89, my first bachelor degree. When we joined the college, there were no hard disks at all. You know, there were just PC with the floppy drive. So we learned very hard way. Now kids are not learning, you know, like as you said, they know input, output, they don't know how, what more should be handled. So that's why coding is important than AI, because what AI algorithms are run, developed using coding only. So the algorithms we develop is in C#, AI algorithm. That means unless you understand the core coding, what you're going to do with AI. Otherwise it will be just a superficial knowledge. It takes input, it gives output, but how it has arrived, how that algorithm works, if you want to tweak the algorithm, you cannot, you know. So you need to, I think, a lot of, start with the core coding, give them assignments. You know, I typically give them a lot of assignments and tell them to solve them. Then they actually, you know, think on this. If I want, even a simple algorithm, find out the odd numbers out of, say, array, you know, that can be also good to start.
So, is there any course websites here from where?
There are a lot of websites are there online, which actually provide a lot of C.
I think there are sessions which are following on AI Bitcoin. Can we take the rest of the questions then?
What is your opinion? The return of investment is okay, acceptable?
Yeah.
No, sir, the point of discussion is, now people are finding difficult. I am offering my job to somebody, he is not capable. So we are trying to make capacity building.
I think I'm directed to Mr. Kamal, because he is in charge of capacity building, then he can answer that.
Okay, so as far as perhaps I would say, this is something which is very important and it's making value. For the reason is, you know, the investment at the stake with a government officer to take up a digital initiative is huge. And those who are taking up this initiative could agree with me. It's more than important that the initiative has been, this investment has been made in the right direction and designed in a way that it will sustain after some time. So the officer is taking into an initiative and the initiative will die down with the officer. The moment the officer is transferred, the initiative will die down. So in that, if you see that context, yes, capacity building is really creating value within the
world. Dr. Murthy, Dr. Sonar, Shweta Kuranaji, of you for your kind input. I would like to thank the excellent audience, wonderful interaction. I think the panel experts are available. We can discuss during coffee and other sessions too. Thank you so much.
Thank you, panelists, for a very interesting session. Now I would request Sri Kamal Jain to present the mementos to the panelists. Information System Technology, Sailesh J. Mehta School of Management, Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay, co-founder WKA Technologies Private Limited, IIT Bombay. Srimati Shweta Purana is the Director of Corporate Affairs of Intel India. She is responsible for driving multi-stakeholder alliances for building innovation capabilities across emerging technologies.